Ich sage wenige Worte zur Begrüßung. Zunächst mal willkommen in Berlin und im SO36 Lori Penny. Mein Name ist Katharina Pühl, ich arbeite an der Rosa-Luxemburg-Stiftung, die Berlin, die diese Veranstaltung in Kooperation mit der Helen Panke aus Berlin. Birgit Ziener, wo bist du? Wink mal mit der Hand. Gerade sehe ich sie nicht. Und vor allen Dingen und zuerst natürlich mit der Edition Nautilus und Katharina Florian, die hier neben mir sitzt, zustande gekommen ist. Nicht zuletzt hat die Edition dafür gesorgt, dass das zweite Buch von Lori Penny wiederum in einem linken, kleineren, vergleichsweise zu den großen Riesenverlagen erscheinen konnte. Auch das war schon eine politische Vorausgeschichte zu diesem Buch und deshalb haben wir auch darauf Wert gelegt, nicht in die Urania oder an andere Orte, die uns abwerben wollten, mit dieser Veranstaltung zu gehen, sondern hier im SO36 zu sein, was auch Lori gerne wollte. Ich sage nicht viel mehr, nur stelle ich vor, Stefanie Lohaus, die genau auf der Bühne sitzt und den Abend moderieren wird. Sie ist Mitgründerin, Redakteurin des Missy-Magazins in Berlin und freie Autorin. Und Iris Boss wird uns dankenswerterweise eine Passage aus dem Buch nachher vortragen, damit wir den Original-Sound und Text hier auch wirklich haben, bevor es dann in ein Gespräch geht zwischen Stefanie und Lori und schließlich in eine gemeinsame Diskussion, wo Fragen gestellt werden können. Martha, die diese Veranstaltung für uns von der Stiftung aufzeichnet als Audio-Video-Aufzeichnung, hat mich gebeten zu sagen, dass wir alle Fragen, die gestellt werden, übers Mikro stellen müssen für die Aufzeichnung. Niemand von euch wird zu sehen sein. Gefilmt wird nur das Podium, aber die Fragen müssten mit aufgenommen werden. Und die Bücherfrauen hinten, die den Büchertisch machen, freuen sich sehr, wenn ihr nachher Bücher kauft. Und Lori wird diese Bücher auch noch signieren nach der Veranstaltung. Viel Spaß und viel Freude.
Okay, ja, vielen Dank für die nette Einführung. Ich muss sagen, dass ich, als Katharina mich angerufen hat, um mich zu fragen, ob ich das moderieren möchte, mich extrem sehr gefreut habe, weil ich Loris Karriere schon länger verfolge, ihre Texte lese. Sie war auch schon mal Autorin des Missy-Magazins. 2013 hat sie unsere Titelgeschichte über Lena Dunham geschrieben und auch ansonsten schreibt sie einfach wahnsinnig tolle Texte, zum Beispiel eben in ihrem Blog Penny Red oder im New Statesman New Inquiry, wo sie als Autorin schreibt. 2011 kam dann Fleischmarkt, das wir natürlich auch sofort dankbar aufgenommen haben. Vielleicht sollte man sonst noch erwähnen, was ich auch ganz großartig finde, sie liebt TV-Serien, Popkultur und Science-Fiction so sehr wie ich auch. vielleicht können wir da auch noch drüber reden. Aber jetzt wollen wir erstmal einen Auszug aus ihrem Buch hören, vorgelesen von Iris. Vielen Dank.
Schlampengeschwätz.
Hello. Hi. Thank you. I want to say thank you so much to everyone for being here. This is very unusual for me. I apologize that I don't speak German, so this is going to have to be in English. I'm really sorry. But before we start with the next bit, which is us talking, can I I guess it's a bit unusual, but can I ask you all to give a huge round of applause to the person who's been doing the most work for this tour for the last 8 days and more, which is Katharina Florian. She's over there. She may or may not want to stand up. I don't know. Go on, stand up. Go on. You're amazing. None of this would happen without Katharina and everyone at Nautilus. Thank you.
All right. Okay, now I already have tears in my eyes a little bit because it's so, yeah. what I also wanted to say is that it's incredibly, so many people, it's incredible. And also, because a lot of you didn't get in, there is the idea that there will be another reading on Friday, which maybe, we don't know yet, but we're working on it. So if you have friends who didn't get in, you can tell them to follow either Laurie
at
Penny Red or at Edition Nautilus, or be friends on Facebook with Edition Nautilus, and then you will find out if we found a place in this short time. Exactly. So, it was, what is it? It's the first time actually I heard the text in German because I only read the English book. And what I didn't get in the English version was actually how romantic the whole chapter on love is. I found it really romantic.
I'm glad.
Yeah. and it made me think that the problem you have is not the problem with love or relation, it's with the commercialization of it.
Oh, yes. I mean, look, I'm a huge romantic and I'm really soppy and I love weddings as long as they're not my wedding. None of them so far have been my wedding. And nobody has ever asked me to be a bridesmaid yet. I wonder why. So, I don't know. But look, romance is like everything else. It's fantastic as long as it's not forced. Right? Romance is an amazing thing as long as people aren't forcing you to make it the cornerstone of your identity and telling you that your whole life is over if you don't achieve this one thing. And actually, romance happens in all kinds of different ways than the ones we read stories about and see films about. And you only have to be alive in the world for a very short time to realize that. And I think it's very sad that the official propaganda is that there's only one way of doing it, and you have to find this one person, and otherwise everything is over for you. Look, I know this sounds kind of soppy, but or like it doesn't have anything to do with politics, but it does. It does. 'Cause the way we are made to talk and think about romance right now is fundamentally about economics as well as about social control. It's about forcing people into households in a very specific heteronormative model, which, and you know, the history of all that is about property. Yeah. The history of all that is about control of women's work and women's identity. And 100 years ago, we had the church to tell us that we were sinful if we didn't do this, and now it works on all on its own. We have the cult of love, the cult of romantic love. And I think it's really interesting that people aren't questioning it right now. Well, I hope people are. People on the internet are. That's great. Yay, people on the internet.
Well, the whole concept of marriage, of course, as you just said, is about property. In Germany, and I know it was in England, the law was that the husband could forbid the wife to work if she didn't do her job in the household until the late 1970s, so it's not such a long amount of time. But right now we are having this debate on marriage between gay people, and what do you think about that? Because that always, I think everybody should have the same rights, but then I'm like, why are they buying into this stupid property, unromantic concept?
It's absolutely essential that queer people have the same right to ruin their life as everybody else.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Okay, that's kind of a no-brainer.
Yeah.
And, you know, we live in a system where marriage is still, you know, a legal institution that gives people rights, it gives people tax rights and gives people rights over family visitations, and you have to have that. You have to have equal. But look, I am not an academic in queer studies, but the decision within the gay rights movement to focus on marriage was very specifically taken. You know, there is, you know, there was a very specific decision, particularly in the 80s and 90s after AIDS and after the, you know, the queer movement was under so much pressure and facing so much prejudice to say, well, we are going to win in this vein by playing within the system and saying we are normal like everybody else. Mm. And that's not valueless. You know, there's huge strides have been made. But at the same time, it's not the reality for most of the queer people I know, right? I'm really interested in how... I'm actually going to my first gay wedding in my peer group. It's going to be amazing. In, like, a month's time, it's my best friend from childhood, and all the wedding invitations came on Georgia O'Keeffe postcards, which all looked vaguely vaginal. And it was so wonderful. They were really fancy. It's going to be brilliant. I'm going to get so drunk. But look, like, most of the queer people I know aren't thinking about getting married right now because they're more worried about getting a job and not being fired for being trans and getting access to treatment and hormones if they're trans and fighting prejudice in their families, which is still a thing that, you know, we're talking about marriage. We're not talking so much about homeless queer kids. And I think there is something we can miss if we decide that everything is one, now we have marriage. In the same way that within the feminist movement, we decided about 20 years ago that everything was one, now we had the right to equal pay for equal work, which, by the way, we still don't have in practice. You know, it's a first step, it's not the end.
You're right, of course. What I was wondering is...
Thanks! We can all go home now.
Yeah, okay, let's go home. Just read the book and... Whatever.
It's fine, just read the books, okay.
No, so I'm trying to elaborate a little bit on the parts I thought about that I kind of missed in the book, because, and that was what is inevitably connected to the concept of marriage is, I believe, sex work. Because, it's part of the whole idea about what a wife does in bed and how men can have access to... sexuality. Uh-huh. And I was a bit wondering because I read some stuff about feminists who want to prohibit sex work, and they're using a lot the neoliberal...
Sorry, please continue.
They're using a lot of the neoliberal argument that you're using in your book. Your book is against neoliberalism, and they say that sex work is neoliberal, and therefore it should be forbidden. What do you say?
Well, look, all work is neoliberal. and if they're going to then argue that all work should be forbidden, I'm not going to argue with them, right? I think, you know, it's like, oh, yay! So many lazy people in the audience. So many. Sorry, no, I'm also a militantly lazy person. I think I'm going to write a slacker manifesto. In which Netflix will feature prominently. Yes, sex work is the commercialization of female sexuality. So are a lot of other jobs which aren't explicitly called sex work. One of the reasons it's important for a lot of people within the sex workers' rights movement, and as an ally I take my cue from them, is to say sex work rather than prostitution, is to locate it as work. And work can be all kinds of different things. I think for conservative feminists and conservative thinkers, when they hear sex work, they hear, oh, work is fantastic. Well, we're saying that work, it's work, so it must be amazing. You know, work makes you a better person. Work is the purpose of life. And I'm like, no, work is the problem. Sex is not the problem, work is the problem. And yeah, it's like, thank you. But you know, I'm not a sex worker saying this, so really this is like me repeating the ideas of many activists within the sex work movement. And yeah, I think it's just a wrong-headed understanding of the problems. And yeah, you talk about marriage. What the beginnings of the so-called feminist movement against prostitution were back in the Victorian days, when it was seen explicitly that sex workers were harming married women or women who wanted to be married by sort of bringing down the bargaining power, the collective bargaining power of women. Because the idea is that, okay, sex and sexuality is the only bargaining chip that women have in this unfree world to secure power. And if women are giving it away for money somewhere out there, then that's bringing down the cost. We have to stop it. And I think there's actually, I mean, people within the anti-sex work movement don't say this explicitly. And I'm not sure if any of them have really thought about it in that way, but there is that hangover from that more, much more explicitly prudish state of mind.
Although it doesn't really make sense, because in a way, in the traditional marriage, you're also selling sex for money. I mean, it's very obvious. No.
Well, it's the idea is that marriage is, well, traditional heterosexual marriage. You are meant, one person is meant to exchange sex and reproductive labor for protection and for money and for housing. Although, you know, I think we can get carried away on this idea that, oh, women are meant to, you know, women are free if they can work outside the home. Actually, you know, working class women have always worked outside the home. Yeah. But it's, again, it's meant to be trading your sexuality for protection. And that is a way of controlling women's sexuality and women's reproductive, role. I love that there's a baby. Hi, baby. I'm going to get distracted.
Yeah, we will talk about reproductive rights
later.
No, but let's stick a little bit with the work stuff. Not fun. In the beginning of the book, you're talking about the state of mainstream feminism, mm-hmm. which is a lot about allowing women to work.
Yeah.
And you say that, and I wasn't really sure about how you meant it. I would quote, it is her freedom that is prioritized as states across the world cut services and provisions while championing the cause of women in boardrooms. So what you mean is quotas and this whole discourse on career women.
Yep.
And I was a bit wondering, do you think that this is harmful actually towards women, or do you just think it's just, you know, helping a very small group and it does not really help the cause?
Well, look, it's like the gay marriage question,
yeah.
right? It's like, is this a good thing for people who want to do that? Yes, fine.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not saying that women in the 1% shouldn't be more free. Everyone should be more free, but there is this whole idea that we focus on the problems of one narrow elite spectrum of women, and that will somehow trickle down, like wealth is supposed to trickle down, except it never does.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think I've only been here having really exciting, thank you, feminist discussions over the past 2 weeks, and it's been fantastic. And what I've sort of come to understand is that German mainstream feminism in particular is dominated by this discussion about quotas, well, by the discussion on sex work and the discussion on quotas. And it seems to, and on quotas for boardrooms, when we're not talking about quotas for, you know, kindergarten workers, because that's already sorted. I'm actually pro quotas. I know that wasn't the question, but I think quotas are really, really, are fine, because, you know, we live in a sexist world, and if you think that a boardroom of, like, 10 white guys is meritocratic, then you're basically saying that people of color and women aren't good enough. So, like, I'm really pro-quota in that sense, but I know that wasn't the question. That's just a little... thought I'd get that in there.
No, that's good to know. I find your book so clearly written, and it's like, I'm always like, yeah, that's totally what I think, but I would have never written it this way.
I couldn't understand what she was saying. So it could have been anything. It was great. I thought it was great, but...
But then I found one sentence on page 10, and you say...
Here it comes.
I was like, okay, she means me. You write, the young women of today now know far better than their slightly older sisters, that's me, I'm 36, who came of age in the listless 1990s, how much work is still to be done and how unglamorous most of it is.
I'm sorry.
You wrote that.
I didn't mean to be mean.
Yeah, no, but it's not mean. It's like, it's a little bit like, what did you, you don't really elaborate on this, so I was wondering, what do you mean by this? Do you mean what I think?
Okay, look, I think in the 90s, there was a really strong idea that feminism was sorted and that women could have whatever they wanted, and you know, even if it turned out that so women could have it all, where it all meant, you know, work and husband and career and babies and never any time for yourself, but this was going to be amazing. And you know, it's like it's not a work-life balance, it seems to be a work-work balance. And but look, what I've noticed, and look, I'm really not used to audiences like this. It's amazing, but I'm really not used to it. So mostly at feminist events I go to, even, you know, whether I'm speaking or whether I'm listening, and when young women are talking about this new feminist movement, there are kind of two groups of women. There's the kind of younger women, in which I would include you. Not that we're having a competition about age, because that's anti-feminist. But look, there's the younger bunch of women who are like, yes, feminism is amazing. And then there are the much older bunch of women who are like late 50s onwards, who are saying, finally, thank God, it's back. But then there is this, yeah, you know, it's like, oh my God, where were you guys for 20 years? We've been waiting. And but then there's this whole group of Generation Xers in the middle who didn't really have that movement when they were, you know, teenagers and in their early 20s and very excited about politics. And I think it's a gap. I'm not saying that Generation X is stupid. I'm really not. You guys did Nirvana. That was, yeah. But like,
I was on a stage with Dave Grohl once.
What?
I was doing the camera.
Did you see what he did this weekend? Did you see he broke his leg on stage and he kept on playing? That's amazing. Sorry.
That's all right.
So good.
Yeah. No, okay, I can totally relate to that. And it's a bit like I needed some time to find out we still need feminism as well. It didn't come for me when I was 15. It came a bit later. But what I also think is really interesting at this sort of in-between, not feminist, women, they are inspired by the new feminism as well, because I know a lot of women who are like in their 50s and they're like, I tell them what feminism is, and it's a bit strange because I'm like, you should know you're older. but they some of them do feel inspired as well.
I hope so. Well, there is a huge energy around feminism right now, and I think it's the same for the same reason there's a huge energy around radical politics of every kind right now, which we've had a crisis in capitalism at the same time, or another crisis in capitalism at the same time as we've had a huge change in the communications technology. Mm. I mean, those two things together mean that people are realizing that everything's not okay, and people have the technology to talk to each other about why things aren't okay. Mm. And this is, you know, it's changing really, really fast. Like, when I was at school in the 90s and early aughts, you know, I thought I was the only feminist at my school. I knew one other girl. We held hands and we met on an orchestra trip, and she's amazing. And yeah, I follow her on Instagram now. She's still really pretty, but very clever. but now, like in the UK, just in the UK, in the past 2 years, 200 feminist groups have been started at schools and universities in the UK, and that's astonishing to me. Like, in every age group, there is this huge uptick in feminist thought and activity, and I'm kind of jealous of the people who are 15 right now and don't have to think they're the only people out there, but I'm really, really excited too. I think it's brilliant.
Yeah, I hope it's really the start of something as well. Well, let's talk about the men. For a feminist book, there is a lot of pages talk about men and masculinity. And I liked that, and especially I liked that you positioned yourself against Hannah Rosin and her theory and some other thinkers who sort of tell the tale that women will profit from the crisis of masculinity and the unemployment of masculinity. Mm-hmm. And you say, no, that's not true. Can you explain why?
Well, I mean, Hannah Rosin's book, so I'm really distracted because everybody leaving has amazing hair. I'm sorry, I think this is just a German thing. Like, you all have amazing hairdos, and I'm like, oh, wow. That's an amazing... I'm being embarrassing. But, look, Hannah Rosin's book, The End of Men, was based on a very short period in America where briefly there were fewer women who were unemployed than men, and briefly women were doing better in the recession, partly because they were getting all the low-paid jobs, because women are preferred for low-paid service jobs in which there is no progression and very, you know, little money and security. That period has now ended. It only lasted about 2 or 3 years, and we're back to the whole men do better at every stage of society thing again. But her argument in The End of Men is that there is this crisis in masculinity, and it's caused by the economy. And the strange thing about that is that, you know, you look back to the 1890s, and then to the 1930s, and then to the 1970s, and then every period in history where there has been a crisis in capitalism and huge unemployment, there has been a public panic about the status of masculinity. And this is why I say in the book, you know, anarchists like me say, you know, capitalism is not in crisis, capitalism is crisis. And I think you can say the same about traditional masculinity. Masculinity is not in crisis. Masculinity is a constant state of crisis. And I many of my best friends are men. Oh, thank you. Yeah. Some of my best friends are men. And, white straight men, and we talk to each other about men things. And they kind of, I get the impression that this is so, that it, to be a man right now is to constantly worry about your masculinity, which is, you know, masculinity is much more coded in terms of the workplace and achievement. And, you know, whenever there are a lot of young men, particularly in society, who don't feel like they can achieve what they were promised as kids, that is phrased as a crisis in masculinity rather than a crisis in capitalism. And it's a huge distraction.
But isn't it because all power is insecure? Power needs to be constantly, now I don't miss the English word.
Renewed?
Renewed or, it's really unstable, you know, all power structures. So masculinity is about power structure. Right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, but masculinity itself, I mean, patriarchy is a power structure. Masculinity is a form of social control and identity. And I'm trying not to get old Judith Butler here, although Judith Butler's really cool. But, if you talk about patriarchy, you're talking about a power structure, and it's important. You know, some men get scared by the idea of patriarchy because they say, oh, well, you're telling me I'm part of patriarchy, but I don't have any power. You know, I don't have a job. I have like X amount of money and I buy a video game with it and that has to last me a month. It's, you know, that's not being a patriarch. And it's really hard to hear that male privilege, you can have a lot of male privilege without having a lot of power. Patriarchy is not the rule of men. Literally, it means the rule of fathers. It means the rule of it's like dad power. It's like a few, mostly men, almost overwhelmingly white people at the top of a social hierarchy imposing order on everybody else. And that's why we say the man, right? Although sometimes the man is a woman, especially in Germany. The idea that patriarchy is just men against women is not true. It's a few guys against everyone.
Is that why you think it's so important to make men part of the feminist movement? I mean, you have a clear statement that you want to include men into the feminist movement, though.
Oh yeah, yeah. It's, I mean, I think men have a huge amount to gain from being part of the feminist movement. I don't think we should change the word feminism. Please don't ask me that. Please. Thank you. It's always one. Can we call it masculinism? Because it just sounds so scary. I don't like it. Stop it. It's called feminism for a reason, because everybody is oppressed by gender, but women and queer people are oppressed more. And, you know, if you don't like it, you can go over and have your own little movement in the corner and we'll come back to you when the revolution is done. Thank you. Yeah, it's really, really important to include men in feminism. At the same time, look, my sort of way of doing feminism and writing about it is to be inclusive and include men, and I try to not be like, oh, I hate men, but look, some of my best friends hate men, and I don't, and actually some of them have pretty good reasons for that. And I'm not going to turn around to them and say, oh, no, you just need to be nicer. You need to just be less angry. Like, you know, I've sort of chosen to take on that position, but I think I'm not going to stand out there and say, look, you should never hate men because it's never men's fault. Sometimes it's men's fault. And that's okay to say as well. Thank you, the two people who are clapping.
That leads us to another question. I was wondering, who is we? I like this whole problem with, you know, like the we, the movement as we, and who are we, and what sort of group are we, and who is included in the group and who is not, and this sort of individualistic approach that we all have a certain identity, and we cannot put our identity onto another person. I have experience as a straight white woman, and you know, people, women of color have different experiences. And you sort of, I think maybe you're sneaking a little bit around this problem, no? And because you don't, I'm not sure. But for example, when we talked about the slut walks, I mean, there was a huge debate everywhere, and I'm sure you know it, about like the concept of the slut walk being racist, and we had that in Germany with Islamophobia, and so how do, yeah, what do you, why is it not in the book? I was a bit wondering.
Well, look, firstly, on the question of the slut walk, I come across this later, actually, when I talked to people who had been on slut walks in Germany and the US. And in the UK, we did not have as much of a discussion around race on the slut walk, partly because my experience of the slut walk was that it was racially inclusive from the start. In London, it happened to be like that. You know, there were lots of, I marched with some Muslim women and people of all different nationalities, but it saddens me to hear that it wasn't like that everywhere. Mm-hmm. And obviously everything can, you know, things can be improved everywhere, but certainly in the speaker list in London we had, it was very diverse. Mm-hmm. But I'm saying in the book, it's always really hard to write a book which includes personal experience that's political without trying to say that my experience is the same as everybody else's. And it's particularly hard for someone like me who's used to writing on the internet to do that in a book, because I'm, you know, I fuck up on Twitter all the time. You know, everyone does. You know, I have huge amounts of ignorant white privilege and I'm learning all the time. And I'm used to, you know, if I write a piece and I've made a mistake or I've not been inclusive enough, people will tell me. People do tell me, sometimes at great length. And that's fine. That's okay. I go away and I have a little think and I leave Twitter for a day and then I calm down and I realize it's not about me. But with a book, you can't do that. With a book, it's out there. And I've actually put in my introduction, I was like, please just, if I've got something wrong, just see you on the internet. It'll be fine. I have not talked a great deal about race in the book, although I've tried. I've not mentioned race, but I don't have a huge chapter on racial difference because I simply don't feel that I'm in a position to speak for women of color or to represent. I mean, my learning since I wrote the book has come on in massive stages, and if I write more books in the future, I will try to be even more inclusive. We can only do better. But yeah. I find it very distressing that there is an idea that we should have a representative feminism, and for some reason the people who get to represent feminism are straight, white women from the West, normally from English-speaking countries, who have had a privileged education and, you know, are grew up middle class. And I'm almost all of those things, not all of those things, but, you know, And even, you know, I fit that stereotype almost exactly, and people are like, why are you so different from every other... And it's like, no, really, I'm exactly the same as those guys. I'm just saying something a bit different because I'm from the internet and I've heard of intersectionality.
Okay.
Basically. Like, that's what I can only try.
Okay. Let's talk about what you just said. It's so interesting here, and we had this a little bit before, because it's surprising for you that in Germany you are everywhere in the media. You're like in the, and everybody's sort of agreeing, even like the conservative media, the left, the queer feminists. I don't know. It's really to watch this. It's a bit like, okay, wow, you're like a star now. And I was wondering what it was like in Britain. Is it the same in Britain?
Look, I was talking to, I was lucky enough to have lunch with Anna Wisarek just before this. Everybody give a clap to Anna, who's right there. And we were talking about the different ways people are treated, and I'm like, babe, nobody is a hero in their hometown. So I think we should maybe swap. And you can have London, because I'm done with it. Sorry. Like everybody else, I'll probably just move to Berlin. Everybody's moving to Berlin. But look, it's I actually didn't realize until I got here quite how... Sorry, am I holding this? Is it okay? Is it all right? Okay, good. I didn't realize till I got here that it would be like this. You know, Katharina was like, Laurie, answer this interview with this lady on the phone. I was all the way out in Boston. I was like, okay. And then I got here off the plane and it was like, whoa, okay. I'm used to doing readings for 10 people is great. Yeah, 10 people is great. Normally you have really good conversations afterwards in the pub. But yeah, I have no idea why this has taken off with me in Germany, because I didn't write, I wrote this book partly in the knowledge and the expectation that other people would write more popular books about feminism, that so I could be more radical over in the corner. I mean, I hoped I'd sell some books, but you know, and I think I probably do get a lot more of a pass because I'm not German, I would say. You know, I think just in the way that American feminists get a lot more of a pass in Britain because they're not British. I have left the UK because I am a sensitive person and I can't always handle the volume of hate that I get there. It still gets to me via the internet, but at least they don't know where I live. So I don't, if people send me a bomb threat, I know that they can't, that's not real. It's a real, I'm trying to make a joke about it, but I'm failing to because it's actually quite distressing. I'm sorry.
So, yeah, so it's like a vacation here.
Yeah, it's a holiday in celebrity. And then I'll go home and people will be like, oh, Laurie, hey, where have you been?
Yeah, I was wondering if it had something to do with that you're not challenging direct power structures because you're from another country. Because, like, I know, for example, that I work with mainstream media, and I know that they don't want certain public feminist figures to write or to have a good review in the newspaper because it's challenging their real power, sort of.
Can you explain more about that?
I don't know.
No, go on. Let's have some Missy magazine.
I cannot say names.
No,
I
of
guess.
Course.
But I know that from big papers, I know that they have sort of an order from the top to
what?
that an editor is not to write about a certain feminist book, even though or they supposed to write a bad review or something. Because
Whoa.
And even if the one feminist female editor, yeah, they're like
anti-feminist
in the newspapers.
Are there
of
any
course.
Freedom of the press people in the audience? Because you guys should get on that.
No, and I mean, they're allowed to write about you because it's a little bit like, yeah, this British crazy author, you know?
Yeah,
it doesn't. It's not like you're not in the power structure of Germany. So that's an idea I had. I don't know if it's true, but
is incredibly enlightening. Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to talk, we don't have so much time
left. We have a little time. It depends how long people want to stay, because I'd love to have lots of time for questions, but maybe people want to stay a little after 10, if that's good. I mean, I don't mind people, you know, get up, go to the loo, get a drink, it's fine.
Yeah.
I believe this place would like you to buy lots of drinks. And it also makes for better conversation, so everybody wins.
I mean, I have so many, I have two more pages of questions. Don't worry. They're optional. No, one question. I wanted to ask my last question now about reproductive rights. Mm-hmm. We had the baby here.
Hello.
You write about reproductive rights, and how do you perceive the uprising of the, I don't know, new right and the new right movement and the new, the evangelical movement, which is quite new in Germany, actually, but you're traveling a lot. Do you think this is an international phenomenon?
Well, I just want to be clear. Are you talking about the new right, like the rise of far-right parties, or are you talking about the new kind of backlash on abortion rights? Because they're two separate, I mean, they're linked, but they're two separate.
Yeah, well, I'm actually sort of talking about both because I thought about the link, but... Mm. We can just talk about one of those and you can choose.
Well, I mean, I can start with the abortion rights thing. There's a huge backlash on the right to safe legal abortion across Europe and in the United States. You know, in Europe, we've had really conservative laws just passed in Spain. Ireland is still a nightmarish place for anybody with an unwanted pregnancy. And the US is just sliding further and further into, you know, Brave New World territory where nobody has any rights. To terminate a pregnancy. And reproductive justice is the it should be, I think, the heart of feminism for a great deal of people because, you know, you talk about the means of production as an ownership of the means of production as the heart of socialism. Control of the means of reproduction is the heart of feminism. And you cannot have a progressive... You can't have a progressive movement for women's rights without that basic thing. It just doesn't work. You need equality, you need sexual and reproductive freedom. And what depresses me, but interests me, is the fact that, look, we have the technology to make women and men truly equal. I'm talking about people who occupy the political categories of women and men here. There are a lot of other people out there. But we have the technology to make women and men truly equal in terms of sexual freedom and reproductive freedom. We've had that technology for well over 50 years, and it's only getting more and more refined. The technology isn't the problem. We don't yet have the political will. We don't have the moral update that we need to make that. We have everything we need to create that reality. It's very easy, but we are stuck fighting against contraception, fighting against abortion rights, fighting against people's right to basic control over their own bodies, which is the heart of patriarchy, really. And the rise of the evangelical movement is partly a backlash against all kinds of progressive culture because abortion rights is a really easy territory to win people back to the right because there is this strong moral case being made. It plays into the root of misogyny and it's fundamentally anti-family. A lot of it's against the patriarchal family, whereas it is comparatively easy. You know, in Ireland, they've just passed gay marriage. This is a huge deal, but at the same time, women are dying because they can't get safe legal abortions, and that is not a happy, fun thing to talk about. You know, you don't have a massive party to celebrate somebody's reproductive freedom, but it is just as important, and it's that territory is not being won, and I feel like more feminists and mainstream feminists need to make that the heart of their argument. I actually think in this book I didn't write enough about it, and I'm sorry for that. Okay. Oh, thanks.
And now I give up my privilege of asking questions to you. And if you feel more comfortable in asking questions in German, you can ask in German and I will translate, or you can ask in English. And there's a microphone. Okay. Who wants to ask a question?
Go on. Oh, hello.
Hello. Is it over there? The microphone?
Hey.
Over.
We have the technology. It is going to be fine.
We just have to use it.
We just have to have the will.
Okay.
Hi.
Hi, Anna.
My spontaneous question that you asked me to to ask. This is very spontaneous.
It's a secret.
I have a question, and we talked about this before, but I would love to share the conversation with the others here in the room about this whole idea that I sort of have called the Highlander syndrome of not just the media, but also inner feminist circles to always appoint just one person who's in charge of how to say what feminism is, how it works, instead of having like several voices at the same time allowing them to represent feminism. What do you think about that, especially how also women are pitted against each other, of course.
Yeah, do you remember that article? So maybe should you say what you do for the few people in the audience who don't know you?
Yeah, I can do that too.
You can plug your book as well. Go on.
Okay, well, if you say so. My name is Anna Wiczorek. I'm a feminist activist. I started the Aufschrei campaign with this woman here as well. Yes, no? And yeah, I have written a book about feminism. It's sort of an introduction to feminism. It's called Why ein Aufschrei nicht reicht, für einen Feminismus von heute. And I've experienced this weird notion that, of course, damned if you do, damned if you don't. If you're too nice, it doesn't work. You're not allowed to do that. And if you're angry, then everybody asks you why you're angry. And I have also realized that, people actually try to
that
put us
horrible
against
yet.
Each other. Like, I'm, like, too nice, and you're, like, the radical one, you know? Which is weird, because we share same opinions.
Yeah, on most things.
to give you that.
Look, yeah, this is, like, a really good example. Thank you. Go on. Give her another clap. Go on. Thank you. Look, there was this horrible article about, saying, oh, who's the best feminist, Laurie or Anna? Like, this is just the language of patriarchy. This is just, so much of, women are taught to compete with each other for male attention, from a very, very early age, and that is part of the social control of women and girls. And it really saddens me to see people applying that same logic to feminism as if, you have to be the best girl, you have to be, the radicalist feminist or the nicest feminist, and actually it only works if there's lots and lots of people. Like, I don't have the patience you have for explaining basic feminist stuff to idiots, right? I cannot do what you do and, like, sit in a room and think, is sexism really real? Like, yes, fuck off. There needs to be people who can do those things. And I'm absolutely, in the political sphere, there needs to be I would never be a politician because I don't have it in me to stand in a room and compromise some of my principles in order to get basic work done. But I understand that some people do need to do that work, and I'm really pleased that people are doing it. We need a huge multiplicity of voices. And also, we're both, white cis women, and it's like we're the faces of feminism. Like, it's ridiculous. Feminism is so broad and so big, and it really depresses me to see this stuff happening, and I'm really glad we can talk about it. Sorry to put you on the spot. Thank you. Anybody else go on? I'm going to start. I only know about 5 names, and I'm going to start calling people by name. Oh, there's a lady here.
Second row.
Person here.
Hi. Is this working?
No, okay.
Hello? Okay, I'm a little bit shy, that's why. I wanted to ask you about, I read in your book this story of when you were younger and you found friends while being bulimic, right? In this
Anorexic, yeah.
But yeah, yeah, exactly. And I was, that really hit me. And I was thinking about how we maybe build friendships in like shared pain more than in like shared strength. And I think it's like actually a very strong thing to like build on your shared pain, also like not only as women, but also like as people who are silenced and like all this other stuff. And I wanted to ask you how you, where you see like more possibilities for like shared strength, like where you see rooms for that, or like also maybe very personal, like in your personal history. Yeah.
Thank you, that's a really interesting question. Look, part of the reason I talk about hospital in the book is that for me that was a really important moment in realizing that we came from all these different backgrounds, all these different girls, and actually there were people from a lot of different countries in that hospital with me, and we all had the same kind of responses to very different traumatic situations. I have experienced shared strength in the activist movement, and I'm really lucky to have done so. I hate being one of those persons who's like, oh, the Occupy movement, it was so wonderful, but it really was an amazing feeling to be involved in the student movement in the UK and later to report on the Occupy movement and feel this new confidence that people had. And I think, I don't know, in feminism right now, it's kind of, it's the same in many ways. There is a sense, even despite the backlash, that we're winning, that we're changing something. And sharing that joy is really, really exciting on online and in person. I'm really excited that you guys are all here. I think it's kind of a real, I think it's a really interesting moment for cultural change, because it does come out of shared pain, you're right, but like meeting each other and building stuff together is also strength. I'm not sure if I'm giving a very coherent answer. I think you probably have a more coherent answer, and I would love to hear it after. Thank you. Go on. Oh, thank you. You don't have to clap every time. It's okay. Could have some guys. Oh, someone at the back. You are now representing all men. No pressure.
No. I would like to ask you about some... recently in the mainstream media, we have seen things such as, Beyoncé presenting herself as a feminist. We have seen now in TV series stories about polyamory, etc. Do you think there is a sort of danger of things such as feminism or the contestation of monogamy, etc., becoming mainstream and therefore domesticated in the favor of the system? Or do you think it's cool and positive that we're seeing these things on mainstream media?
Okay, look, obviously I liked feminism before it was cool. Thanks. And I want that down. But yeah, look, okay, I just want to make an observation here, and I'm not getting at you, dude, in any way, but you are the fourth person in a week who has asked me about Beyoncé. And they have all been white people, and they have all been like, oh, well, is Beyoncé really a feminist? And look, there are many reasons why I'm not going to do down on Beyoncé, mainly because I know a great many LGBT people who would have my head for it, and I love those people. But I think it's really problematic when we, like, ask, you know, whether a particular, very successful black woman's, you know, way of being, of doing feminism and having power is really right. You know, do we really approve of this? I don't think it matters whether we approve of it. Beyoncé is amazing, and she will continue to be amazing whether or not we... Thank you. I don't see a problem with the mainstreaming of feminism, which was your actual question. It's, you know, like the Beyoncé song, Flawless, which is actually quite hard. You know, she drops in a minute-long clip from Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, one of the most important writers in the world today. I think the best novelist in the world today. And, everybody clap Chimamanda. She's amazing. Yeah, she's wonderful. And that clip dropped in the middle makes the song impossible to dance to. And I have tried, like in a disco, in a kind of club situation. Well, not impossible, but a lot harder. It's like there's this awkward bit and you're not quite sure what to do. Should we be like cheering or listening or like continuing to dance? But like the effect of that is that millions of people all over the world and young kids have heard the word feminism and a minute-long explanation of what it means. And I'm never going to say that that's not a good thing. Never. Right? It's... Thanks.
Hello.
We can share.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to say something because I've been asked a lot of times to do interviews for the radio, and they're asking me, is blah blah feminist? Is Kim Kardashian feminist? Is Miss Piggy feminist? And I'm always like, the problem is that you're asking. No, it's like I'm saying, like, well, I'm not the feminist police, and I cannot. It's not like there is some sort of checklist. What is feminism?
Yeah.
And it's also that feminism is something you call yourself a feminist,
yeah.
And then what you do is feminist. So, and then we can talk about it if we like it or if we think it makes the world better or not or whatever. So I'm sure you can discuss these things, but it's not like it's feminist or not feminist.
Yeah,
that's...
Like feminism as an identity is really great, but ultimately feminism is not somebody you are, it's something that you do. And, you know, I think, yeah. It's like, I don't care, it's like this Highlander battle, like Anna said, it's like what... You know, who is the best feminist? Let's now judge. We stop judging each other for. Oh, we still judge each other for how we look, and you know, who's the best mother? Who's the best career person? Who's the most beautiful? No, it's who's the best feminist? And it's just the same. It's so anti-feminist, that question. And I'm not saying that some people's feminism I don't agree with, but that's the whole point. There are many kinds of feminism. Some of them I think are really fucked up, but I'm not going to say that. They're not feminist. We just have differences of opinion within a broad movement. It's anybody else? Yay!
Ich möchte meine Frage gerne auf Deutsch stellen. Beziehe mich auf das, was ich gehört habe in der Lesung.
Hören Sie mich jetzt?
Ja.
Also ich möchte meine Frage gerne auf Deutsch stellen und beziehe mich auf das, was ich gehört habe in der Lesung. Also Sie haben, ich habe gehört, dass es eine Bewusstseinsänderung bedarf. Und jetzt ist meine Frage, und da habe ich gehört, dass wir uns nicht mehr schämen sollen. Es bedarf ja immer einer Grundlage. Ja? Also wenn ich an Marx denke, der sagt, es muss für das Bewusstsein muss es ja eine Grundlage geben. Was ist dann die Grundlage für die Bewusstseinsänderung? Die kommt ja nicht, fällt ja nicht vom Himmel. Ja, woher kann diese Bewusstseinsänderung kommen? Was befördert sie zum Beispiel?
Okay. Well, she said that she heard in the reading that what we need is a change of mind, a change of consciousness, and that we should not be ashamed anymore. And she's asking, she says that the conscious has some basis in Marxism, for example.
Yes.
And so she's wondering what is the basis for this change of consciousness that you're talking about.
I'm sorry, can you explain that? Are you able to explain the last bit again? I know it's translation.
What's the basis? I don't know. Maybe somebody can explain it better. Or no.
Are there any bilingual Marxists in the room?
Because I think it's a bit complicated.
I bet there's
question.
One. Oh, here, there you go.
What's the...
bilingual.
Can you...
Oh, yeah. So what Marx, or no, what the lady was saying, if I get her right, is that according to Marx, a consciousness always has a certain foundation.
Yeah.
Foundation.
Assumptions.
That's the word.
So her question was, how do we bring about this change of consciousness without tackling the foundation first? Where is the change of consciousness supposed to come from?
This is a really interesting question. Thanks, both of you. Yay! Look, I don't believe that you have to wait for the socialist revolution to have feminist change. I think consciousness, when we talk about consciousness, we talk about sex is a social idea. Power is a social idea. Work is a social idea. All of these ideas are grounded in hegemony and they are grounded in our economic system. I just happen to believe, like, you know, a lot of Marxist feminists believe, you know, para Shulamith Firestone, that the foundation of the economic system is both capitalism and patriarchy. I think that in trying to change patriarchy, we are trying to change the economic system, because patriarchy is an economic concept at its root. It's about controlling the means of reproduction, controlling women's labor, keeping everybody under control in that way. And so, yeah, I don't think this is what you were saying at all, but I kind of, you know, I've had the experience on the left so many times where people are saying, oh, feminism, you know, you guys can sort that out when we're done with the boy thing of making, you know, socialism happen. Actually, I don't think you can have a socialism that makes any sense without feminism being in it from the start. A lot of people disagree with that, but that's my position.
Sollen wir es auf Deutsch nochmal übersetzen, die Antwort? Okay, oh wow. Puh.
No pressure, darling. It's gonna be okay. I can't remember what I said.
Also, was sie gesagt hat, ist, dass sie eben nicht daran glaubt, dass wir erst quasi auf die sozialistische Revolution, also ne, diese ganze Hauptnebenwiderspruchsgeschichte, also dass man nicht erst den Hauptwiderspruch beseitigen muss, sondern dass eben Patriarchat und Kapitalismus Hand in Hand gehen, also dass Patriarchat auch nach Shulamith Firestone quasi eine Art der Verteilung von Arbeit und auch Kapital und so weiter ist. Also es geht eben zusammen. Und sie sagt eben, dass man auch dass durch Feminismus sozusagen sich auch der Kapitalismus angegriffen wird oder verändert wird. So.
Can people please give her a clap? Because that sounded like a really hard thing to do just then. Yes.
In this direction, it's better.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Bit louder.
A bit louder?
No? Yeah, that's great.
Okay, according to the question of we do need different feminist movements along the question of black or white or I don't know. Mm-hmm. I do sometimes ask myself if this is really necessary, because sometimes I remember moments when I was sitting in the bus or something and I was reading a book and I really felt empowered by reading a book, because I felt like part of a group, you know, like the feminist group. But then there were parts where you were talking about women of color or I don't know, people in general of color. And then I had a moment that I felt like I was alone in a country where most of the people are white, and this made me feel like a bit more separated from this feminist movement. So sometimes I really do ask myself, do we need to separate it, or aren't we more powerful if you're talking about a group in general than instead of along white or black, for example?
Thank you. Look, thank you for that. And I don't know the answer. I wish I had a clever answer for what we do in terms of feminism and anti-racism, and I don't think I'm really the right person to give an answer on that, even if I did know. When I was writing the book, I was, you know, in the middle of a period of anti-racist education, and I hope that if there's anything in my approach that I've got wrong, that, yeah, people like you will tell me, even if I've, you know, phrased it in a way that is suddenly excluding people. I'm, you know, I think I have so many different understandings of what people of color need from feminism, and I think it is different country to country. And some people don't want to identify with feminism at all. That's fine. There's still a lot of people using the term womanism. Everybody's experience with this kind of stuff is different. And I'm sorry this is a shitty answer. This is what happens when I try and think at the same time as I'm speaking. I think you probably know more about that than me. And if you want to come and talk to me afterwards and tell me how my next book could be better, I would really appreciate that. I guess that's all I can say right now. I'm really sorry. Is that, thank you.
Okay, I try first in German, then in English. I'd like to go back to the question of conscience. Also, was ist das Bewusstsein? Warum haben wir so vielleicht dann doch andere Gedanken über Gleichberechtigung? Und ich glaube wirklich, dass es daran liegt, dass wir in Westeuropa Zugang zu Bildung haben, immer mehr weibliche Studentinnen, immer mehr Frauen in Arbeit, die ihr eigenes Geld verdienen und die ihre Geburtenkontrolle haben. All that things you pointed out in your book, so wonderful. You know, in your book, I learned from you to get focused again on right of abortion, right of education, right of to decide to with whom I would like to live or not to live. And we have this in Western civilization. And for that reason, I think we can have a new conscience to more feminism. This is what I think, and I'd like to point this out to the woman, to the Frau, die gesagt hat, wie ist das eigentlich mit dem Bewusstsein? Wo kommt das eigentlich her? Gibt es dafür eine gesellschaftliche Grundlage? I think there is a basis for that.
That was brilliant. We have two people here. Here and there and there.
Coming here, I was reading an article that really recently, I think this week, the FDA in the United States approved Viagra for women. And I was reading this article and I was really like...
Who was that?
Oh, I'm pro, and they talked about a movement which is supporting this new drug, or yeah, even the score. And I was really positive. Like there are 66 drugs for men to get their what they want, and now finally it's addressed the problem for women. And then I heard that behind this campaign is a pharmaceutical company, the same one who supports the drug, yeah. So, and I was thinking, yeah, what do you think about it? Because I think it's still positive, but yeah, women should have less stress and then be more relaxed and have less gender problems and so on, but I think still it's important to show that it's an issue, and yeah, thank you.
Look, capitalism ruins everything, basically. Actually, look, thank you, the Marxists in the house. There will always be a pharmaceutical company behind a new drug as long as we have the medical system that we do, particularly with the US drug companies and their crazy laws about advertising, which, you know, I actually, this is kind of a tangent, but I took a course on biotechnology just this year and went into some of the legal issues around advertising in pharmaceutical advertising in the US. It is utterly unbelievable how they just change whole bits of the advertising law to make it so you can just advertise and say, this pill we're going to make you happy, even though there are many, many more complications. But that aside, look, I am really pro-body hacking in any way that people think it... Oh, thank you. there's where the weirdos are sitting. I'm sorry, that was really mean. I didn't mean to be mean. But yeah, I will sit with you later. But look, I'm really, really pro using technology in any way that people feel they need to achieve the kind of life they want. I'm a big fan of the Cyborg Manifesto, and people, you know, I think people, you know, should be able to change their bodies however they want. You know, the contraceptive pill is cyborg technology. The, you know, safe medical abortion is not natural. The question is, are we going to be choosing these things because it's because we feel social pressure, or because we really want to have a better time in bed? I mean, both is possibly going to happen, but it's as long as people feel they are doing this kind of thing for through free choice, then yeah, great, new drugs, wonderful. But I can really see, sorry, maybe I gave something away. But I can see the debate. I can just anticipate the sort of conservative feminist articles about, oh, well, you know, encouraging, we already encourage women to have too much sex, and this is just from men, and it's patriarchal because they want to have more sex with us. And actually, I think a drug that recognizes that female desire is a thing is a small positive step, and I'm not going to say any more because I'm not sponsored. And they should, if they want me to say any more, they should pay me some of that drug money. I can see there are more questions, but I actually, while I was listening to the German things I couldn't understand, I was thinking more about your question. I don't know your name, I'm really sorry, and I think there is a reason for the discrepancy that, you know, when I'm, you know, talking about general stuff and talking about race and say, oh, and people of color. Do you guys mind if I answer that again? That's just, oh, thank you, okay, good. Because yeah, I want to just answer in the way people want me to. But like, look, I felt this huge tension writing the book. You know, a lot of pressure to get things right, whilst at the same time not feeling like I could speak for people. And this is why I think I tried to write in a general way. And then I thought, you know, have I adequately represented people of color? Maybe I should just put in a line here. And I think that's the tension that you were reading into it. And, you know, I'm not, my anti-racism and my experience in anti-racism is still coming on. And I hope I will be less shy and more willing to ask questions with a expectation that I'll be sometimes wrong in the future. But that's also part of, you know, writing a book. You can't ask as many questions. Yeah, I guess that's it, I hope. Does that explain more? I just felt like I gave you a really shitty answer before, and maybe that was slightly less shitty. I don't know. Thank you for letting me do that. I feel better. And it's really all about my white guilt.
Okay, there was one person over there. I think she was first, and then here in the... Over.
Okay. Just very quick, I just wanted to add something for the Viagra thing. The pill is not called Viagra, it's called Pink Viagra. And it's called Pink Viagra, and they didn't try to make something for the pleasure of women. They tried to find a new medicine against tumors. But it didn't work, so the mice didn't react for that. But the female mice got very horny.
Amazing.
Yeah, and that's why they decided to produce this pink Viagra. Yeah, that's what that was.
That is no fascinating, questions. And those are some lucky mice.
I saw you, but I think were you first? Because I think she was first. Okay.
Alright.
Just add, but very quickly.
Yeah, I just want to ask that this kind of stuff always happens in pharmaceutical tests, and the guys that research Viagra.
The guys that research.
The original Viagra, the people that research the original Viagra, they were actually looking for something for medicine to care blood pressure, too high blood pressure, and they build something that actually builds up your blood pressure. Well, at least if you're a man. So that happens all the time, and they just got lucky and got something to sell. So.
Thank you, Captain Splaney.
Over here, first row.
Thank you for walking up and down all evening.
Okay. I would like to ask about the term slut that we heard a lot about by the reading of that chapter of your book, and I was wondering, what do you think would be best to do with that term? The German word Schlampe is, I think, equally hateful, and the reclaiming of the word. I'm conflicted if this word can be reclaimed in a positive way. I'm not sure if I'm making if I'm making that clearly.
Yeah.
But as we were told, the word slut and the word Schlampe, they originally meant a woman which is lazy and untidy and filthy, and that is all that stuff that you're advocating that we should have any right to be and to do, which I totally understand. But yeah, I'm not sure if that is a term worth reclaiming and worth owning. Maybe by undermining heteronorm relationship models, like in being an ethical slut. But I'm not really sure about that. And just a fun question. What do you think about Mad Max Fury Road?
Oh, yeah! Thank you. Last question first. It's amazing. Everybody should see it. I'm not sponsored by that movie either, but it's really, 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 really great. It's like the best summer movie. Okay. Look. Okay. Mad Max Fury Road. It's only called Mad Max because they had to. He's not the main character. It's brilliant. It has old ladies on motorbikes counting bullets and saying, one man, one bullet. Remember that. It's so good. And, okay. No doubt, over. Look, I thank you for your question. I acknowledge that it is a really uncomfortable thing. And I'm trying to be provocative in the chapter, right? I understand that this is not a thing that's going to make everyone comfortable. But I think one of the reasons that queer people first decided to reclaim the term queer is because it made people uncomfortable and because it forced people to confront their own internalized homophobia, their own fear of, you know, being not normal and being something that people despised. And for me, when I say I'm a slut, this is great. I'm trying to confront my own internal sexism and my own fear of being judged, and that's why I think I think reclaiming is a difficult thing. In language matters, reclaiming is difficult, but it's a process that people. Oh God, I said process like an American. Sorry. Oh my God. I am having an identity crisis. But yeah, it's a process that is really useful in terms of examining your own issues around social pressure, because yeah, slut is still a term of abuse, and it's still a term of abuse almost exclusively used against women and for women who don't behave well. And reclaiming the word, you're also reclaiming the thing, and you're saying maybe it's okay to not behave well, maybe it's okay to not go for, you know, being the good girl and being considered a nice girl and well-behaved. And I think that's what it means for me. I understand that people have different reasons for not wanting to reclaim it. In the US, there was a big pushback by women of color, particularly African American women, to say, actually, this means something different within the African American community, and you should think before saying, we should all call ourselves sluts. I get that. For me, I'm just talking about, you know, my experience and the experience of a lot of other people that I know. It's different across different demographics. I hope that helps. Anybody else? I'm not mic.
Oh, okay. Hi. So I'm almost afraid to say this given what you said in the beginning of the evening, but just a few weeks before we had the referendum in Ireland, I started the German gay marriage equality campaign. Hey. That is now the biggest campaign. And thank you. And I just wanted to respond. First of all, I wanted to respond to something that you said before, because I don't believe that the romantic concept of marriage is the main reason why we're doing this. Mm-hmm. I believe that, first of all, for me personally, it's the idea that I really want the government to stand 100% behind me. Otherwise, I don't know how to fight everyday homophobia and all the stuff that you talked about. That is very, very important. I totally agree with that. But I think that it's a big statement that we don't have the marriage equality in Germany right now. It's a big statement. It's a big problem, not only because I want to get married. That's the first part. And the second thing is, my question for you is, the other reason mainly why I'm doing this is that in heterosexual marriage, you have the natural opportunity, let's call it, yeah, I don't know how to call it, but let's stick with that. The natural opportunity to have two people responsible for a child. Mm-hmm. You make this child together most of the time. And and if we don't have gay marriage, how would you achieve that situation to have two people equally responsible for caring for a child without the concept of marriage, gay marriage?
Thank you.
Legally speaking.
I thank you very, very much. It's and thank you for what you're doing. Look, I want to make it clear that I'm not against gay marriage. All right. Okay, good. Good, good, good. And I think that, you know, in terms of legal rights, it's really, really important to start there. And it's... But in terms of who is responsible for a child, I think the legal system ought to be much more flexible even than it is already. Look, I know people who have... Thank you. Look, I know two children who have three parents, who have been had taken equal role in raising the kid. And in each case, they've had to decide which one of the parents is not going to be on the form, which one of the parents is not going to be able to visit the child when it's sick. And it's, yeah, I think gay marriage is just the start. There needs to be a broader system for, you know, recognizing different families within the legal system. But yeah, I think you're right. Gay marriage is an important start. Thank you. Hey. There was a lady at the back first, and then this person. Okay, yeah. Yeah, you guys are in the dark over there. I love that all the biohackers are in the dark corner. What are you doing there?
I'm not biohacking, but I did want to ask the question. It's not on, is it? Yeah. I did want to ask the question about your point with reproductive rights and what you were mentioning before about the pill being a cyborg technology. I'm not so sure, and I think you also said I should talk much more about reproductive rights, and I agree maybe because it's a topic that's come to me personally in an irritating way, and I think that's why I find your writing so powerful, because like Hannah Arendt, who was a woman and a political woman, bear with me, sorry,
No.
But who always made a point of saying, why is the private political? And for me, who's, I don't know, maybe not put enough thought into this, and now to find my biological clock ticking, it's very, very irritating and also embarrassing experience to some extent, because you then realize how suddenly your body and your what you say is might be a power is actually doesn't feel very empowering, or it turns you into sort of semi social figure, or you're constantly negotiating the private-public sphere of this. And this is, it makes something very embarrassing, I think. I'm interested in your point with the cyborg technology. I don't know if you're aware, but one of the people who was working on the actual chemicals of the anti-baby pill in the 50s in Mexico, on the really the basic chemical
formula.
He, after he'd done all this work, he's a very, very young man. He's got loads of doctors, and he went on to become a playwright to write about lesbian over 50s couples doing in vitro technology. And he's a big, his name is Gerassi, and he's someone, I don't know, maybe he should get a Nobel Prize in chemistry or something. But at some point, I mean, basically, I think feminist thought or ideas in that context, what you were saying, a biotech, that can come from really different directions. And I thought this is an ancient old man, but he's literally cutting edge and he's shocking people with his drama. And these are the kind of things we have to be talking about. And these are the kind of people who are ignored on all fronts. And I mean, women. And he's a professor with a very very well respected. And I'm thinking, how do you get this discussion in public without embarrassing yourself, without going around like I'm doing, you know, I want to get pregnant, and telling people who have no business about this? And how do we find a discussion that isn't separating to women who don't want to have children, who do have children? In Berlin here, you have this massive hate towards Prenzlauer Berg Muttis. I'm sure you've all heard of it. And it's very divisive, and it's very sort of forcing you into the private. Do you have any thoughts on that, on the sort of private-public balance that to achieve here in debate?
Oh my God, I have so many thoughts on that.
Okay. It was a long question, I apologize.
No, that was, thank you. I'm going to come and ask you the name of the guy. Look, this is a huge, huge issue, and thank you for being so open about this stuff. Really, really big deal. And I think the fact that you're saying this is embarrassing is important, because we are encouraged, female people and people who can reproduce, who have, female reproductive organs are, sorry, I'm still getting that wrong. Please just fill in the right thing to say, okay? It's late. I know the right thing. I'm just tired. People who have uteruses are encouraged to think of themselves as on this clock, and suddenly when you get to your late 20s, early 30s, you're expected to think of yourself on this timetable. Actually, people can have, healthy, viable, normal pregnancies right into their 40s, sometimes into their 50s. This is not discussed because, we don't want this to be part of social reality. But there is a huge, huge conversation that people are not having about the basic inequality that biology still enforces on us, because, guys just get more time to dick around. And I think that is really, really unfair. Guys get 5 to 10 more years in the most productive period of your life to dick around and not decide what you want to do and not be expected to have a plan. And when you have a plan, probably somebody else will make it for you. I am thinking about this a lot right now. And a lot of people I know, I have a lot of friends who are slightly older than me, in their mid-30s, late-30s, who, this is seriously on their mind. And it is... it's embarrassing to talk about. And I think the reason it's embarrassing to talk about is because it's fucking painful. And it is not sorted out yet by any means. And the conversation about that needs to be bigger. I really hope that you'll write about it. I think more people should write about it. Can I talk about science fiction, please? Yay! Okay. But when you're talking about fiction... and imagining different ways of living. I'm a huge reader of science fiction and of feminist science fiction. And people have been talking in these fiction books and about different reproductive technologies that actually make it possible for real reproductive equality. I've just finished reading a book by Marge Piercy called Woman on the Edge of Time, which is fantastic, even though she's a transphobe now, which is upsetting. Where she says, in this future world, babies are born in tanks and everybody looks after them, and it's much more of a mutual thing. And that idea is horrifying to modern society. I mean, babies born in tanks, but actually, when you think about it, why aren't we working on that technology? Why aren't we working on technology to get women to make sure that, you know, people have the option of having babies without going through the enormous work of pregnancy and labor. I have about 10 friends who are in the process of either they've just had babies or they're pregnant right now, and I'm stunned by the work it takes and by the trauma of it and by the it's a huge deal, and people just talk about it as a lifestyle choice. It's made me more pro-choice because I don't understand how you could force anybody to do that with, you know, with and still consider yourself a decent human being. It's thank you. But yeah, on a personal note, I've been actually, we've been talking about this in the last week, I've been trying to figure out how to write about this myself, and I'm not sure if I want to, you know, put my own worries down on paper and have everybody see it. I'm not sure if I want to, you know, put that out there. I put a lot of stuff out there, and that's politically important, but it's really putting your pain out there and your worry is really, really hard sometimes. So thank you for sharing yours, I guess. We've got time for like two more questions, yeah. Maybe.
Two more questions over there in the. Oh, now everybody wants.
Hi, I just wanted to go back to the reclaiming concept of, for example, slut. I'm speaking as a Latin American woman who is considered white in her own country. I live in Europe. I'm speaking English. So I cannot speak for every Latin American woman I know. And we cannot, most of the time, afford to reclaim certain words because it's a matter of life and death for lots of women. You cannot say, okay, it's so cool, I'm a slut. Maybe you can get killed, you know, at the corner of your house, or your boyfriend doesn't find it that cool, and then you're done. And you lose lots of things by reclaiming certain words. So that makes us be seen as not progressive enough in certain feminist circles. And at the same time, we have to play through the patriarchal rules. We cannot be that progressive as maybe we would like to be. And my question is, do you think it's possible to achieve change by playing by the rules of the patriarchal system, especially for women that cannot allow themselves to be as progressive they like to be? Is it possible at all, really, to keep playing all of us by the rule and make any change at all? Or we have to say, okay, fuck everybody and leave anarchy and we just throw down the government? I mean, if it was possible, it would have happened a long time ago. So, yeah. So it's like,
got more?
So do you think, really, to repeat just a question to make it clear, it is possible to achieve change even though we are still playing, most of us still playing by the rules?
Thank you. Look, thank you for making that point, and I hope I addressed it before, but yeah, I think it's really important to acknowledge that there are different costs for different women for making the same statement. I'm more and more aware that personally I get to say a lot of things without being yelled at quite as much, that some women just would not get to say with the same anger, the same kind of public radicalness. You know, I have that privilege. I'm trying to use it in a way that I feel is useful. But yeah, you know, being white, being from an English-speaking country, being, you know, middle class, I get to say a lot of things and claim a lot of words that are of less, you know, they cost me, but they cost me less. I am really aware of that. And I don't take it lightly, so thank you for making that point again. In terms of using the master's tools to break the master's house, I think you can do it. I think sometimes the master's tools are pretty good for housebreaking. I am not cynical about the possibility of broad social change, mainly because I make myself not be cynical. I was talking to a girl the other day who had a tattoo on her wrist which said, "Hope is the last thing to die." And I want to copy that tattoo because I think it's really, really important to convince yourself that change is possible, even when sometimes, you know, like in the UK with the recent elections, it feels so far away. But whether I think it is absolutely possible to make change happen without being the most radical person in your own life. It's, yeah, everybody has their own choices to make. I make choices about what I'm going to say and not going to say. You probably make different choices about what you're going to do and not do. Everybody has to live within patriarchy. It's like Marx saying, you know, we have to fight change from where we are. You know, everybody has to live within capitalism. And I think it's really, like people who say, oh, you can't be a feminist if you wear makeup. You can't be a feminist if you... Me too. Makeup is amazing and so much fun. Everybody stop telling me not to wear it because I'm not listening. That's a side point. But your more important point is that, yeah, everybody makes their own... Everybody has certain choices about what they will, what they are and are not prepared to give up. And people have different costs to that. And, yeah, that's really important to acknowledge. I'm sorry if this is coming across stilted. I am yet again trying to think as I speak. So, yeah. That was really important. Thank you. We have time for one more.
One last question. Okay. Over there.
Hi, Laurie.
Hello.
I have many thoughts in my mind, and I hope to get it straight. First, I wanted to say to the guy over there who said something about the pink Viagra thing and how it came. Hi, yeah. I think it's good that you're here because what you said is one of the reasons why I'm here too. Because I don't need men to explain the world to me, and I hope. Thank you. And I hope you take a lot of this evening for yourself. And just like I did. I learned a lot today still.
Me too.
I think we're all not perfect. And I. It's funny that Steffi is here too, because when I was in at university...
speak a bit louder.
When I was in university at Münster in 2011, I visited a seminar with her, and she kind of changed my life to feminism. Thank you for that.
Now I'm starting to cry.
I still have a question. Laurie, when I read your newest book, I was wondering, you're talking a lot about revolution.
I'm sorry.
You're talking a lot about revolution, and I was reading your book and thought, yeah, all the time. I was like, yeah, let's go to the streets and have that revolution. But the thing is, what's the point of going to the streets if I think the feminist revolution has to happen in our minds? And just like I'm from a working class family, I had to go to university, and I think I'm very privileged that it was possible I could be there. And many people don't have that possibility. And I just think, how can we reach them? How can we tell everybody what you are saying, what most of the people in this room are thinking? How can we put feminism into the minds of most of the people? All of the people in the world. How can we make this happen?
Whoa. Look, that's a huge question, and I am not sure I have the answer. I'm trying to do my bit. I think it's a big collective movement to make this stuff happen. But I'm really... Look, what you say about stuff in the streets not being the be-all and end-all, I think, is both important and relieving, because there is a huge crackdown on public protest happening across Europe and the world right now. So thank God we don't actually always have to go to the streets. But look, a lot of the changes we're asking for, some of them are legal changes. Yeah, that's true. You know, reproductive rights, quota systems in parliament. Yeah, that's a legal change. I'm coming to my point. I'm sorry. But a lot of the changes we're talking about, like what you talked about in terms of, you know, biological inequality, these are cultural changes and social things that need to change. And the bad thing is that you can't make a law that changes all of that. You can't fight for a law to change it. But the good thing is you don't have to fight for a law to change it. So we can bypass all that and actually having conversations and talking to each other and raising awareness and creating campaigns, like, you know, at least two people in this room have said that they're doing, is really, really important. It gets change done. And this is why, you know, I'm not a techno-utopian. I don't think the internet is here to save everything, but the internet has changed a lot in terms of how fast the conversation can go, how broad the changes can be. And I'm really, really excited and hopeful, even though sometimes things seem very depressing, and I'm really glad that you are too. And that's it.
Well, thank you, everybody. Thank you for making me cry. No, I mean,
thank you.
It's really strange, but a lot of times when I feel, when I see progress, you know, that I really see people, like, it's a little bit, because I feel a little bit flattered, but
you
no, but it's like, it's makes me, it really touches me, because it's like, okay, I don't know how you perceive that, but I feel like I'm doing something and it actually sort of works. I mean, that's like the craziest thing in the world, you know.
It's amazing. We're winning. Yeah, it's so exciting.
We started this magazine in my living room, and we also learned a lot, and you make me think that. So but it's just, I'm so glad it works. And that makes me feel actually really optimistic, even though sometimes I'm really pessimistic. But well, thank you all
thank
for
you
coming
so
anyway.
Much.
It's, I mean, it's wow. I mean, next time we book a stadium, and
maybe we can have some boy cheerleaders.
Yeah,
that's it. Thank you, Yet.
Likewise. And well, yeah, thank you all for thank you for coming.
Thank you
for writing your book. Thanks for Edition Nautilus and for Katharina again. Thanks for all your questions. And of course,
Ingrid.
Oh my God. Yeah, Ingrid.
Where is she?
Where is she?
Ingrid. Oh, there she is. Everybody
come on,
clap.
Applause.
Come on. I think they're going to make me sign books at the back. Yes. And I think, is the bar still open? I'm not just asking for myself. But yeah, we can hang out and get drinks and that would be cool.
Okay.
Revolution starts at the bar. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you very much, everyone. Bye.